Hello, you multi-muciferous, maverick, multi-grain muffins. Some hot mention. Welcome to the Bothy. Welcome to Ralfy Review 997 extras. And a big mop mention thank you to Purushtam 9353, who provided the mop mention. Because when you have a mop mention, it means Ralfy's in the Bothy, somewhere in the Irish Sea, about to do a review. And this is an extra, you see. This isn't a traditional standard bottle of spirits review. I'm giving additional content here, and I'm just talking a little bit about the wider interesting observations that relate to drinking whiskey. And I want to talk about reading books, the connection between reading books and drinking whiskey, which is a lot stronger than you might imagine. But when we're reading a book, we're using our senses, and we're using our sense of eyesight to read the words, and then our brain interprets the words. And it's quite a complex procedure. In fact, it's very complex. Very, very complex. And I've written books myself. And I'll just, because we're coming to the end of the year, we're into October, right? And it gives me an opportunity just to remind you that I have published books. You'll find them on Amazon and in good bookshops. Not the bad bookshops, just the good bookshops. And my first book is called Search for a Whisky Bothy, which is really a memoir, an autobiography of how I got into whisky and how I started my whisky channel. And it gives you anecdotes on the whiskies, the characters, the whisky tasting events back in the late 1990s, early 2000s. And my second book is called Stories from a Whisky Bar. And it's a collection of short stories, not specifically about whisky, but about people who drink whisky. So these are stories related to whisky. So it's kind of bringing whisky into context of human experiences, whether someone happens to be getting murdered or is being threatened with an old pensioner's home when they still have some years of freedom ahead of them. And this is the problem when you've got family making decisions for you in their interests and not your own. But those are two examples. There's a historical chapter about illicit distillation and the dangers of it. And there's a rather charming one about the old Clyde Puffers and how active they were in moving casks of whiskey from remote distilleries to Glasgow for bottling. And then my third and final book is, because I'm writing another one now, a fourth book, but it's a bigger project, big project, takes several years. It's called Life, Death and Whiskey, and it talks about whiskey in relation to the job I did when I was living and working in Glasgow as an undertaker. So I'm giving all sorts of funeral related anecdotes. Some are absolutely tragic and some are absolutely hilarious because it's real life. And when we pick up a book, whether it be one of my books or whether it be any book at all, we get into the story. Within the first couple of pages, we decide, I'm enjoying this, it's going to be worth reading, let's immerse ourselves in it. And we enjoy the flow of the language, the sense of humour. We enjoy the honesty of the content. We enjoy the little eccentricities of observations. There's so much in a book that we can connect with. And it's exactly the same with a glass of whiskey. And I want to give you an illustrative example, because when we pour a glass of whiskey, it's like lifting a book. We nose the whiskey, we'll taste the whiskey, we're not quite sure what to make of it. So it's like starting to read a book. We're asking ourselves, will I enjoy this or not? And then you come back to the whiskey, and then you start to kind of get the plot. You start to build with the characters of flavour and sensation, just in the same way as you start to develop your connection with the books as you start to read about the characters and the plots and the plot twists. And then we have a taste of the whisky and we spend some time with the whisky, just in the same way as we immerse ourselves in the ongoing story within the book we're reading, until we have finished the book. And when we've finished the book, it's the same experience as when we've finished a glass of whisky. Although I have to say, it takes a lot longer to read a book than it does to get through a glass of whisky, to be honest. Of course, it depends how big the book is. If it's a Ladybird book, wouldn't be a problem, or one of Beatrix Potter's books. But there we go, that's a little bit eccentric. So I'm going to move on and say that something else that books have in common with whisky is that we can change from our familiar brand to a alternative, to another style of spirit. So we may be experienced Scotch whisky drinkers or bourbon drinkers, and we decide, you know what, I'm going to get a bottle of mezcal. And when we first pour a glass of that, it's like lifting a book by a different author on a different subject. We're not sure, we're really not sure how we're going to react to it. We're not sure even how we're going to connect with it. But what we do know is that when we first nose that mezcal and taste it, it's going to be a shock and a confusion to our senses, because our senses simply aren't familiar with it. And the senses need to have time to get familiar with it. And when we are getting familiar with it, we're using our nose and our taste buds simultaneously. I mean, there's a reason why our noses are located directly above our mouths. It's not just for aesthetics. There's a practical purpose, because when we go to taste something, anytime we taste something, it's got to pass by our nose. And our nose warns us subliminally, subconsciously, that's the speed of the warning, whether what we're taking into our mouths is actually poisonous and toxic. In other words, if I was to pour you a little glass of diesel fuel instead of whiskey for a laugh, which I wouldn't do, but let's pretend I did, and I handed it to you, you'd go, oh, that's not a whiskey. What the hell? And you sniff it again, and you'd sniff more carefully as you brought your nose into the glass. That's car fuel. And then basically you dump it down, you wouldn't touch it, because you know to consume that would be poisonous. It would give you a very upset stomach. This is why our noses are directly above our mouths, so as that we can smell before we taste, just to be sure. And when we taste, say, a mezcal or a rye or a rum, for example, instead of the whiskies we usually have, we can get this little knockback moment where we're going, oh, whoa. And the brain's saying, hang about, this isn't the usual stuff. This isn't the recognisable. This isn't in my memory banks. This is something else. So expect that moment. You will find that there are many whiskey drinkers who tend to stick, not maybe to one brand, but one style of whiskey. They may be peat fans, or they may be Sherry Monster fans, or they may be Highland Malt fans. And they don't really explore much with other whiskies, despite the opportunity to do so. They don't tend to try English whiskies or Irish whiskies, for example, or even a Welsh whiskey or two, because they do exist. And they say, no. I'm just sticking to what I know, because that's what I'm comfortable with. And you'll find these are sort of people, if they're reading books, they'll only read one type of book, because it's just the way they're wired. So we're not making a judgment call on it. But I mention this purely as a passing observation, that the more time we take to observe our lives, the more we see our patterns repeating, whether it be reading books or listening to music. You could be a big orchestral, modern classical music fan, and suddenly somebody gives you a CD or an MP3 download, of concrete jazz. And you think, you know, I'm not going to enjoy this. But the more time we spend with it, the more patience we have in connecting with it, then the more we can actually delay the decision making as to whether we're going to enjoy it or not. And as a consequence, be surer in our decision making. So when you're trying any alternatives or alternatives to whiskey or bourbon, never rush it. Keep an open mind, but at the same time, follow your own instincts on it. But when you make your decision, make sure you've given your decision enough time. Don't just smell, taste and say, nope, garbage, and shake out the glass and you go back to your habit, your familiar. Because inevitably at some point, when we get over familiar with our habitual points of reference, we start to get a little bit stale. We start to not enjoy things so much because literally, inevitably, the novelty of the familiar starts to wear thin. And at that point, we always benefit from starting to explore again at the diversity and range of flavours and sensations and the delivery of them in bottles of spirits. I'm Ralfy. Thank you for watching my extras. Subscribe if you haven't. I do have a Patreon channel, and if you want to leave a comment, I'll give you a wee thumbs up and all the rest of it, as long as it's a decent comment and a polite comment and an appropriate comment. In the meantime, thank you for watching, and don't forget, you're wonderful.